Hey, y'all got quiet. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Friendship Baptist Church. It's so good to see each and every one of y'all smiling faces this morning. And I hope it's because that your heart's filled with the love of Christ. You know, we had a conversation in our Sunday school class this morning and how sometimes we say that we love folks, but a lot of times we'll put conditions on that love. I mean, if you behave a certain way, I'll love you more. Well, I'm so thankful to know that my Savior does not put conditions on His love for us. Amen? Amen. This morning we're going to open up in the chorus book, page 45. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Real quick this morning, I'm going to have Trevor stand up and talk about the cruise in coming up this Saturday. Trevor.
All right, so this coming up Saturday, up on the board, we've got our Christmas Miracles cruise in. It's from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. You're welcome to come and join us. There's no entry fee, anything like that. You know, bring a hot rod, bring a regular car, or whatever, ride your motorcycle, pull the boat. We don't care. Everything's welcome. But what we're doing is, you know, as you come in, we'll accept donations. Like I said, there's no entry fee, and this is strictly to raise money for children within the church, children within the community, stuff like that. Every single penny that's donated goes directly to them for their Christmas. It's not just gifts. It's necessities like, you know, clothing, school supplies, stuff like that. So we do have several sponsors now, which is pretty awesome. It's been a community outreach at this point, so hopefully we can not only fill the needs of the church, but we can spill over into the community and help out other children in need as well. So please come out and join us. Like I said, it's next Saturday from 10 to 2. We will have a barbecue food truck coming. So come out, join us, get some barbecue, and just hang out for a good time.
Thanks, Trevor. Also coming up on the 18th of November from 8:30 to 1:30 is the blood drive. You can see Miss Janice about that. You can also, if you have an account with the Red Cross or have their app, you can go and search for the church blood drive and sign up that way. So I know that they want us to have 39 donors. Is that right, Miss Janice? And we've got 15 or so already signed up. So just remember that and come out and give if you can. Any other announcements that I'm missing? If not, if you stand to your feet, I'll ask the ushers to come to the front this morning for the offering. Greg Purcell, will you lead us in prayer?
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come unto you today, Lord, just lifting your name up in praise and worship, Lord. And Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come out to your house. Lord, we thank you for our health, Lord, that you've blessed us with. Father, we saw some people this morning that haven't been able to be here in a while. Lord, we just thank you that they were able to make it this morning, Lord. It was so good to see them. Father, we pray that you continue to be with them and help them and bless them, Lord. Father, we thank you for just everyone within our church and all that they do, the outreaches that are out there, Lord, that they're working, Lord. They're out trying to spread your word, Lord, to a lost and dying world. And Father, we pray this morning for those that are on our prayer board, Lord, those that have lost loved ones, Lord, those that are hurting, Lord, and those that are less fortunate. We pray for peace for Israel, Lord. We pray for our pastor that's going to bring the word this morning, that he would bring us a message that we need to hear, Lord, and that we need to take out to the rest of the world. Lord, we ask all these things in thy Son, Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
In the chorus book, again, page 133, Somebody Loves Me. As they play, y'all move about, shake one another's hands, welcome our visitors. Miss Ann is here with us this morning, and it's so good to see her again. So y'all move about, spread a little friendship love, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
232, That Heavenly Home. Ricky asked for the choir to come up because they tend to sing out a little more when they're up here, you know, in front of me. So we want everybody to sing out because, you know, that's something we have to look forward to one day, a place to go, that Heavenly Home. So y'all sing out.
About it. God's people said.
Amen.
Wasn't that good?
Amen.
That heavenly home
will surely be mine. But until then, we've got today. Amen.
Amen.
I was talking to a pastor friend of mine just the other day, and we were talking about the kingdom. And I said, oftentimes we look for the kingdom as to be something way off out yonder, when the fact of the matter is, if we've been saved by the grace of God, we're already a part of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And we ought to be enjoying it while we're here on this earth. Because if the world sees you and I enjoying the kingdom, they may get a little curious and they might want to know what you and I know. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you something right now. It is good to be back at church today. I was excited to come back this past Wednesday, and then when we wound up having to cancel, it broke my heart, and I was so let down, and I thought, my goodness, I was so looking forward to getting to come back. And but boy, today I'm just excited, and Michelle and I were able to go to, anybody ever heard of Zach Williams? How about Toby Mack or Mercy Me? We got to go see all three of them. And matter of fact, there's some others that was at that concert. Raise your hand if you was there. Wasn't that fun? That was a good time. And from the time it started, Zach Williams started out with a song called Big Tent Revival. And I'm telling you what, I felt like I was in a big tent revival. There was people all over that place raising their hands and shouting and standing up. It was awesome to be there. And so I got excited during that. And Mercy Me, of course, they sung their classic, I Can Only Imagine. And that was awesome. And then they ended up with a song they do called Happy Dance. And y'all would throw me and Michelle out of church if you saw how we acted when they sang that song. Because we done a happy dance, didn't we, hon? We had a good time. And so I hope that I hope you're excited to be at church today. I'm excited to be at church today. I need this, don't you? And I hope that you need it too. I want to share with you out of the book of Acts some verses that God has placed on my heart, and I believe that He wants us to share with you today. And we're not going to probably read all of it, but there is one verse in particular that I want to share with you. Then we'll go back and kind of give a little background and what led up to this. And we'll just kind of go from there. So you pray. I know we got lots to pray for, a lot of folks to pray for. We had to actually try to make some room on the prayer board this morning to get the names put up there that needed to be up there. And so I hope if we took somebody down that shouldn't have been took down, please, by all means, let us know. But as you can see, there's only so much room. So lots and lots to pray for. And certainly I know that you will remember to pray for them in prayer. Acts chapter 4, and I want to share with you verse 20. I want to share with you verse 20. And I'm going to read it here. I'm going to read it in a couple of different translations as well. But Acts chapter 4, verse 20 says, "For we cannot but speak the things we have seen and heard." For we cannot but speak the things we have seen and heard. The NIV says it this way: "As for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard." Can't help but speak about what we've seen and heard. The Message paraphrase, I love the way the Message paraphrase puts this verse. It says, "As for us, there's no question. We can't keep quiet about what we've seen and heard." Now, that's good stuff, isn't it? We can't keep quiet about what we've seen and heard. Where did we lose the excitement about what God has done for us? We can talk about everything under the sun. We can talk about the weather. We can talk about ball games. We can talk about concerts that we go to. We can talk about everything, it seems like, except talking about the Lord. Now, I realize that when we're in a church setting, when we're all here together, brothers and sisters in Christ, guess what? I understand that when we're all together like this, it's easy to be a Christian. Because we're in the house with like-minded individuals. We're in the house that believes the same thing that we believe. And so it's easy to be a Christian, but we go out there in the world and we're faced with all kinds of things. And now, man, I'm telling you, it for literally from all over the world, all cultures and everything else, and there's all kinds of religions out there, and there's a lot of folks that don't have a religion at all, no kind of belief whatsoever, and we've got all of that that we deal with. When I was a kid growing up, there was two primary, well, really probably three, but primarily you had Baptist, and then you had Methodist, and then you had some Church of God thrown in there along and along, and that's about all you heard of, really. And then the Presbyterians came along, and I thought, my goodness, what is a Presbyterian? And now, man, it's just exploded, and there's everything out there, everything. But I'm going to tell you something. Salvation is nothing at all about religion. Say, what are you talking about, preacher? Let me tell you something. These fellas right here, when this verse was penned, they couldn't help but talk about what they had seen and what they had heard. And what they had seen and heard wasn't about religion. It was about relationship. You know what made that concert so good the other night? It's because none of them folks was perfect. They've been through things in their life. They've experienced things in their life. And they've seen the goodness of God firsthand. They've experienced it in their lives. And God has given them a talent, and they have chosen to use that talent to express what they have seen and what they have heard. And God gives every one of us here today that's been saved by His marvelous grace, He gives us the gifts and He gives us the abilities to tell what we know. Why would we not do it? We know every day people die and go to hell. I heard just the other day how many people per day die on the face of the earth. And it is unbelievable how many people die on the face of the earth. I could not help but wonder how many of those folks go into eternity, lost and undone, doomed for a devil's hell, that will never know the love of God, never know what it is to spend eternity with Him. That ought to wake us up, amen? It ought to make us think about our surroundings. I believe it like this. I believe God saw maybe that His church wasn't going like we ought to, and so He just brought the world to our doorstep. That's what He did. You don't have to go very far from this church to find neighborhoods that is literally full of people that's not like us. They're from a different part of the world, but they've come here. Why did they come here? Well, if you ask them, they would give you various reasons why they came here. Some might give you the same reasons. It might be because I read an article in the paper not too long ago that was talking about a lot come here because we have a good education system. And that's good, and that's well. But they all come here for various reasons. But this is what I believe. God sent them for the reason, and God sent them into this area so that you and I would have opportunity to do what? To tell what we've seen and what we've heard. You know what had taken place here? Peter and John, let's think about Peter a minute. Peter had told Jesus one time, you know what he said? He said, I'm going to go with you all the way, Lord. I'm ready to go. Why, if you go to prison, I'll go with you. If they put you to death, I'll be right there beside you. I'll die right along with you, Lord. Jesus said, why, Peter, before the rooster crows tonight, you're going to deny me three times. Three times. Peter said, oh, no, never going to happen. And what happened? They arrested Jesus in the garden. They took him there, began that mockery of a trial, if you could call it that. Peter's there among the crowd, and they begin to look at him and notice, you know, he's one of them Galileans. He's not from around here. He even talks like that. He must be one of his disciples. And so they question him about that. Oh, no, I don't know him. I don't know him. Then they see me. Oh, no, no, surely you're one of his. You know, your accent, it all gives you away. Kind of like if we went up north somewhere, it wouldn't take them long to figure out we wasn't from around there. Amen? Wouldn't take them long. We talk different, right? I mean, who else spells dog, D-A-W-G? So there again, oh, you got to be one of his disciples. You must be one. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know the man. And finally, he got to the point. I read this. I never really thought about it. But I read in a commentary, it was talking about that very verse, and it said that literally Peter began to call down curses. Man, I mean, he just buzzed. Man, whatever it took to deny that I don't know this man. I don't know what you're talking about. And guess what happened? The old rooster crowed. And the Bible says one of the writers records that Jesus looked right at him. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Remember, he had made the boast, "Oh, I'll go with you all the way, Lord. I'll go to jail. I'll go to prison. I'll die with you if that's what it takes. I'm yours. I'm not going anywhere." And here he has denied him, calling down curses 3 times, and the rooster crowed. What changed? You see, they had a little experience in an upper room. After Jesus had died and he had come back and the tomb was no longer occupied. Somebody said, you know why they put Jesus in a borrowed tomb? You know why he didn't have a tomb of his own? Because he wasn't going to need it very long. Matter of fact, he needed it for about what? A couple of days or so. And the tomb was empty because he had been resurrected. He told them, he said, before he ever died, he said, "Look, I have power to lay my life down, and I have power to take it up again." You know what he was saying? Listen, no man took Jesus' life. He laid it down for us.
Amen.
He laid it down for mine and your sins. And he had come back from the grave, and he had begun to appear to those, and they had begun to see him and begin to converse with him. They saw him ate a piece of a broiled fish and some honeycomb. They knew it was the Lord. They had seen and they had heard with their own ears and their own eyes, and they knew it was him. And there they sat on that up. He said, you tarry in Jerusalem till you be empowered from on high. And the Holy Spirit had come and filled that place. I'm going to tell you today, you and I, when we get saved by the grace of God, I firmly believe with all my heart, the Holy Ghost of God sets up residence within our heart and within our soul. And I don't fully understand all about how it works sometimes, but I know this. The other night, when I sat there in that concert with 15,000 other people, I felt the Spirit of God fell well up within me to the point where I couldn't hardly stand it no more. And I had to move. I had to shout. Whatever it took, the Holy Spirit filled my cup and let it run over. And that's what I want for us today. That's what the church needs today. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. In the room, the Bible says, cloven tongues came and rested on each one of them, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak in other languages that they didn't even know. They didn't have no education. They hadn't learned it from a book, brother. The Holy Ghost gave them utterance. And the Bible says in Jerusalem at that time, there was people from all around the known world speaking all kinds of different languages. And here's the amazing thing. Every one of them heard in their own language. Every one of them heard the gospel. Every one of them heard the message.
Amen.
And those non-believers, you know what they said? "Well, these men are drunk. These men are just drunk." Peter said, "Ain't got nothing to do with that. It's just the night. That was just 9 o'clock in the morning. They're not drunk. This is what the prophet said was going to happen. I'm going to pour out my spirit." And brethren, that's what took place. And they preached the word. They preached what they had seen, and they preached what they had heard. And what do you and I need to do today? The same exact thing.
Amen.
You say, "Well, I'm not called to preach." I didn't say you were. But we've all got a testimony if we've been saved. We've all got a message to tell, a message to share. So what had happened? What led up to this? Oh, Peter and John went up to the temple in the 3rd chapter of Acts at the hour of prayer. And there was a man sitting out there that somebody had brought and laid at the gate called Beautiful. They'd laid him there every day. You know what he laid there for? He laid there begging alms. In other words, he was a beggar. His only means of support was whatever people tossed in his little cup when they walked by. And Peter and John walked by that man that day, and I can almost picture in my mind as he held up his little cup or whatever it was there, and Peter looked at him and he thought, "Maybe these guys are going to give me something." And Peter looked at him and said, "Listen, silver and gold have I none, But such as I have, I'm going to give to you. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you rise up and walk. And that man got up, and the Bible said he didn't just walk. He was leaping and praising God. A man, and you read on, and the Bible says this man was above 40 years old, and he had never known what it was to walk. And there he was, walking side by side with Peter and John. And the people began to rush in. They saw what had happened. They knew this man was lame. They knew his situation. And they began to rush in and wonder, the Bible said, looking intently on Peter and John. And Peter said, "What you looking at? What you looking at me for? As if John and I had done this." And then he began to preach to them about the Prince of Life. Began to preach to them about Jesus. He said, "Look, you desired a murderer. You remember what happened when Pilate was going to let Jesus go and said, 'You want me to turn Jesus loose?' They said, 'No, give us Barabbas. We want Barabbas.' He was a thief and a murderer."
Amen.
And yet they desired a murderer over Jesus. And Peter began to remind them of these things. "It's in the name of Jesus that this man stands before you whole." So what happened? They didn't like it. The priests and the Sadducees and the religious leaders of that day. You get into chapter 4. The Bible says they come up and they heard that man, these men preaching in the name of Jesus. And they didn't like it. They didn't like it a bit. So what did they do? They had them arrested. Thrown in jail. Overnight. The next day they called them out. Set up their little council there. "By what authority are you doing these things? By what name?" And Peter began to give his testimony. Peter began to preach to them about Jesus. And oh, they didn't like it. They didn't like it. But see, all the people was there. They had seen what had happened. They really didn't know what to do with these guys. So they threatened them. And you know what they told them? "Don't you preach in this name anymore. Don't you talk about Jesus anymore. Don't you be teaching about him. Don't you be speaking about him. Don't you be preaching about him. You don't do it anymore." Peter and John says, "Is it better for us to obey man or to obey God? You be the judge." That's what they said. What they said. And then he said these words, "As for us, we can't help it. We got to tell what we've seen and what we've heard." You know what Peter was telling them? We don't have a choice. We've got to. Why? Because it was burning within them. It was what they knew. It's what they believed. It had changed their life. They knew it to be true. Why would someone give it all for a lie? Why would someone give it all for something that was just a myth or made up? Peter said, "Look, we've got to do this. We've got to do it." If you read on, you'll find out they let them go, threatened them some more, sent them on their way. They went and met up with some other church folks and began to tell them what had happened, what had taken place. And here's the amazing thing. You know what the church began to do? They began to pray. Man, did they ever pray. And if you read on just a little bit, you'll find out that after they had prayed, you know what the Bible says? The place where they were at was shaken. You ever prayed till you felt like the ground? I'm going to tell you something. I'll just be honest with you. That music the other night was loud. Was it loud? It was loud, wasn't it? To the point to where sometimes my seat was vibrating. That's the truth. You could feel the floor under your feet vibrate. And I thought, man. When I read, I thought, was that how it was while those people were praying? They prayed and it was so powerful in that moment. And the Holy Spirit was so powerful and so rich in that moment that the place was shaking. They could feel it. They could feel it. So you know what they did? Listen to this. Verse 31 says, "They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and they spake the word of God with boldness." They just kept telling what they had seen and what they had heard because they didn't have a choice. They had to. It was their mission. It was their responsibility. It was their witness. It was their testimony. It was their salvation. It was their relationship. You get it? They didn't get up and preach about religion. They got up and preached about relationship. Head knowledge ain't ever going to save you.
Amen.
Religion, being a Baptist, ain't ever going to save you. Joining the church and getting baptized ain't ever going to save you. Well, preacher, I thought all those things were important. Absolutely, they are. But unless you truly know Jesus, unless you've been saved by His marvelous grace, none of that other really means anything. Never will forget a pastor telling me one time, first church he ever went to, had a baptizing. There were several had been saved that week, and a lot of them were kids, younger kids, and had a pool full that Sunday. Unbeknownst to him, a little boy that had been there that week and a bunch of his buddies had got saved. This little boy hadn't made a move, but he decided that Sunday morning he'd get in the pool with them. And this certain pastor, when it come time to baptize, he was just dunking them. He was just baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Every one of them is in that pool. Went in to begin to change and was sitting there in tiny shoes and said the door filled with a big, tall man, one of the deacons there in the church, and said the shadow filled up the room. Said he looked up and there stood that big, tall fella. Said he had his finger pointed right at me. Preacher, you know what you've done? He said, what did I do? He said, you done went and baptized a sinner. One of them little boys, you see, had gotten the pool that hadn't been saved that week. And Bud Sutton just baptized him anyway. Y'all know Bud Sutton? He just baptized him anyway. He said, well, Mr. Darricott, that was the deacon's name. Mr. Darricott, I can only say one thing. If the little boy wasn't saved, he went in a dry sinner and came out a wet one. Amen.
Amen.
You can get baptized 25 times, but if you don't know Jesus, it still ain't going to save you. We talk about what can wash away my sins. It ain't the waters of baptism. It's being washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Peter said we can't help but tell and you know what we've seen and what we've heard. We can't help it. We've got to do it. You tell us not to, but we're going to anyway. And you know why they was able to? Because they prayed until the ground shook. They prayed until things got right. They prayed until they were filled and endued with power from the Holy Ghost of God. They prayed and they went forth and they spoke the word in boldness.
Amen.
And that's what the church needs today. That's what I need today. That's what you need today. That's what we all need today, is that boldness. Another pastor friend and I was talking the other day, and he said, you know, he said, I've come to realize something. He said, I don't know when I've ever seen a time when people are so receptive to the word, to what we've got to say, if we'll just say it. You see, we get in our head somewhere along the way that people don't want to hear what we've got to say. People don't care nothing about our little country churches. People don't want nothing to do with us. I just don't believe that's true today. We just ain't trying. We've just come to accept the status quo. This is just how it is. This is how it's going to be. We just hope and pray we can endure till the Lord comes back. What an attitude to have. What if that's what those guys' attitude was? What if Peter and John would have said, you know what, here we sit in jail. They told us not to do it no more, so I guess we won't. We'll just pack it up and go on in and hope for the best. We'll take our little group, our little, you know, group of disciples that we've got here, and we'll just try to carry on, do the best we can. But no, one place talks about there's around 5,000 people by that time that had come to believe and accept Christ as their Savior. You see, the Word, you know why we're here today? Because of what happened then. Why we're here today is because those men continued to tell what they had seen and what they had heard. We wouldn't be here today if they had stopped. We wouldn't be here today if they had give up. So the church don't need to give up today. We need to continue to tell what we've seen in what we've heard.
Amen.
You ever seen a miracle? Well, you know, preacher, I don't know if I have or not. I saw all three of my boys come into this world. I saw three miracles right there for sure. Three miracles right there for sure. I've experienced miracles in my life, and you have too, whether we want to admit it or not. Why can't we tell about what we've seen? Well, what's the birth of a child got to do with a miracle? Because it's a creation of God.
Amen.
It's a creation of God. What is history? It's His story. And we've all got one. Every one of us. Mine's different from yours, but we've got one. Isn't that true? Can't help but tell. We cannot but speak, Peter said, the things which we have seen and heard.
Amen.
Amen.
Can't help it.
Yeah.
We just got to do it. Yeah. People may look at us like we got two heads. They may be rude. They may shut the door in your face. They may tell you don't want to talk about this stuff. Don't believe it. Don't want nothing to do with it. Well, okay. I've had doors shut in my face. I've had people be rude to me, and it hurts my feelings. And it really does make me want to say, well, forget it. I ain't doing this no more. Maybe somebody else will talk to them. But we never know, one day after a while, what kind of difference we've made in somebody's life, right? You might be the difference. I might be the difference in somebody spending eternity in heaven or in hell.
Yes.
Amen.
We might be that difference. Oh, is it really that serious, preacher? Don't you speak no more in the name of Jesus. Don't do it anymore. We're not going to tolerate it. We're not going to have it. Well, Peter said, do we listen to you or do we listen to God? And then he told them religious folks, you be the judges. You see, they knew the answer. They knew who he needed to listen to. Supposedly, that's who they were listening to. But you know what Jesus told them in another place? He said, you don't know me. You don't know me. You don't have a relationship with me. You don't know anything about me. They knew tradition, they knew ritual, they knew the law, but they didn't know him. Toby Mack sang a song the other night, but he started it off. He said he started to read the Bible. And a few weeks into reading the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, his firstborn son died. And he said, I laid the Bible down and quit reading. And he said, time went on, and he said, I'd walk by it every once in a while, and I'd look at it, and I'd say, no, I'm not going to do it. No, I'm not going to do it. But finally, the day came when he had to pick it up again. And God restored him and gave him back his joy. And he was able to go on and continue to tell what he had seen and what he had heard. And that's why he's still doing what he does today. It's different. There was a day when I'd have laughed in your face if you'd have told me somebody could get up and rap Christian music, but he does. And does it very well, I might add. But I'm going to tell you something, folks. God can use us if we'll let him.
Amen.
He can use us. It may be a little unorthodox from the way that I growed up. But I'm going to tell you, I felt the same thing that night as I feel right now. Don't tell me it's not real. Don't tell me it's not real. Don't tell me that people can't get the word out and use the gifts God's given them if we'll just be obedient. Peter said, I can't help it. You telling me to hush? You telling me I can't talk and speak and preach in the name of Jesus? I can't help it. I've got to.
Amen.
The old prophet Jeremiah one time, man, I'm telling you, if you want to get to a point of doing the happy dance, don't read Jeremiah. It won't make you feel much like doing the happy dance. There's a reason Jeremiah was called the weeping prophet. That man had it tough, I'm telling you. You talk about a hard-headed bunch, he had one. They wouldn't listen to him. So Jeremiah made his mind up, and he said, I'm not going to do this anymore. I can't do it anymore. Nobody's listening. Nobody cares. I'm just not going to do it anymore. But you know what he said? He said the word of God was like a fire shut up in his bones. And he said, I got to let it out. I got to let it. I can't hold it in. Oh, that the word of God would burn in our hearts today. That we cannot hold it in. The world desperately needs it. It desperately needs it. And we just keep it to ourselves. God, help us today to be bold like those men were. And even though we're threatened, even though people say, hush, we don't want to hear it, you just got to be tolerant. You just do your thing. Let them do their thing. Even though we're accused of being bigots and all of this kind of stuff and intolerant and everything else, called all kinds of ugly things, it's just because we've got a message of hope and grace and love and mercy and salvation in a man called Jesus.
Amen.
And it needs to be told. We can't help it. We've got to speak about what we've seen and what we've heard. How about you today? Do you know him? Have you been saved? All you got to do, listen, it's not difficult. We make it difficult, but it's not.
Amen.
It's not. Believing. Oh, I've doubted in my life. Oh, I've doubted. Oh, I've had to go back. Let me tell you, just recently I went through a time I thought, Lord, what is going on? I don't know what to do. What is going on, Lord? Lord, am I even saved, Lord? Do you know who I am, Lord? Do I really know who you are? I don't know what I'm looking for sometimes, but listen, the Bible says, believe and be saved in the only begotten Son of God. Just believe that he died on the cross, that he shed his blood, and that blood covers your sin. He did it for you, and he did it for me. And if we'll believe that and then confess Jesus saves, Jesus saves. That's what those men did the other night. That's his whole message. Zach Williams, Toby Mack, Mercy Me. It's the same message. And once he's got us, he ain't ever going to let us go. Isn't that good news? Never going to let us go. Never going to let us go. And that gives me hope today, don't it, you? Do you need that hope today? Will you just believe it and accept it and just say, God, here I am. I'm yours and you are mine. And I claim it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I claim it while we stand and sing together. You were there faithfully.
where there was no hope, or seemed like there was no hope, and the only person that you could cry out to was Jesus.
Amen. Bless you, Scott. Come on.
And he was there faithfully.
Yes.
To come and pull you up out of that pit that you found yourself in. Have you been there?
Yeah.
I want to shake your hand if you've not.
Bless you, Lord.
I want to come hug on your neck if you've not. But I'm telling you that I have. And I know there's a lot of you here that have been there too. He didn't wait.
No.
When we asked him to come, he came.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you love us in spite of us, that you come when we cry out to you.
Yes. Listen, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Yeah, I love you, Lord. Yeah.
This is good. This is good.
Amen.
Bless you, Kimberly. Amen. Yes. Yes. Amen. Anybody else? When I cried out to you, Jesus, you were there faithfully. How sweet. Yes, sir.
I don't tell all of Billy. The biggest miracle of all for me. I don't know exactly the age. I know between 16 and 17 years old. But I went to country church. I had a hard time getting in that door. I might be saved right out there. And I don't know. But I wanted to get in real bad. And I got in. And I got all the Jesus come in my heart then. Hallelujah. That's the biggest miracle in my life.
Amen.
Faith being saved. Jesus saving a sorry sinner like me. Hallelujah.
Amen. Every time, it's a miracle.
Amen.
Every time.
Lighthouse Baptist Church has Hell's Gates going on right now. I think today is the last day, as a matter of fact. But, you know, you talk about reaching out to folks.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you what. It was a pretty amazing thing. And I think we've done it in the past at another church. But from what I understand, they've had, last weekend was 500 that had accepted Jesus. And
wow.
Yesterday there was another 80. That
wow.
Accepted. So, you know, we never know what people are going through, and we may, just speaking something, just
yes.
Give them your testimony may help to
right.
Pull them to Jesus.
Right.
Amen. So it's a wonderful outreach. I don't know if you have time to go today to it. I don't know if they'd have any tickets available, but you have to get the tickets online. But
right.
It was pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. Of events that are occurring and what could happen.
Right.
Why the eye opener?
I was glad to hear someone say today about praying for Israel. And we certainly, the Bible says to pray for the peace of Israel. And so we certainly need to continue to pray and keep our eyes and hearts on that situation. But you know what? If the Lord comes back and gets us, it'll be all right, won't it?
Amen.
But in the meantime, if he chooses to leave us here for a while longer, we're just going to keep speaking about what we've seen, about what we've heard. Amen?
Amen.
Thank y'all for being here today so much. God love you, and God bless you. And just keep on keeping on, church. He's not done with us yet. Keep on keeping on. All right, today is our conference day. It's first Sunday of the month, so all of you that can, hang around. We'll go into conference here in a few minutes, and make sure you welcome our visitors, and thank them and ask them to come back. And Miss Ann, sure is good to see you. Love you so much. And thank you, Greg and April, for bringing her. And I teased Miss Ann about her Cadillac. She come in with her new Cadillac. I said, things must be pretty good over there, though, because you've got a new Cadillac. But we love her and just appreciate so much. She and her late husband, Fred, did a lot of ministering. And Fred pastored different places, different churches, and God used him. And just thankful for that. Men like him is what us coming along and following in those steps keeps things going. And we just appreciate that so much. So God bless you. We love you. And as Cynthia and Eileen plays through a verse or two, if you need to go, we certainly understand. If you can hang around for a little bit, we'll take care of a little business, and then we'll be on our way. But thank you again and for being here. Let's just raise our hands up high and say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Free to go.